Reading with your kids. Hey, 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 so great to see you. Come on in. Hi, my name is Jed Lee, and this is the Reading With Your Kids podcast, coming to you from the beautiful Reading With Your Kids studios in the absolutely delightful community of Readville, a wonderful neighborhood in the southwest corner of Boston, Massachusetts. We have a wonderful guest for you today. She's here to tell us about her beautiful new picture book, Sadie and the Paint Shop. We'll be speaking today to Deborah Sherrell. If you are the author of a great show in this book, we would love to have you as a guest on the Reading With Your Kids podcast. And if you're the author of a great show in this book, you are also the head of your business. That's right. And your business is the business of selling your great children's book. And you want to do it right. That's why I think you should check out readingwithyourkids.com/inkfile. I-N-C-F-I-L-E. readingwithyourkids.com/inkfile. Inkfile helps you quickly and easily form your LLC, S-Corp, C-Corp, or any other business. Start your business today for as little as $49 and state fees. There's no contracts. There's no hidden fees. Inkfile has been trusted by over 150,000 businesses worldwide since 2004. Check it out today. Remember, you are the head of a business. Once you write your great children's book, you want to do it right. Go to our website, readingwithyourkids.com/inkfile. I-N-C-F-I-L-E. readingwithyourkids.com/inkfile. We are looking for a few great schools to host our all-new in-school experience, Reading With Your Kids Live. Now, even though you might not be the person making the decisions as to what kind of experiences come into your kid's school, we want you to listen up because you can help bring this exciting new program to your community. Reading With Your Kids Live, we're looking to celebrate our shared love of reading and learning with storytelling, magic, and lots of fun. We may even feature some of the students on a future episode of the podcast. Now, if you would go to readingwithyourkids.com/live, readingwithyourkids.com/live, find out a little bit more about the program, share that with the principal of your school, the guidance counselor, the head of the PTA, maybe even the youth minister at your church or the librarian at your public library. Just let them know that you listen to this podcast, you love this podcast, and you know that Reading With Your Kids Live is going to be a whole lot of fun and a really effective learning experience for the kids at your son or your daughter's school. Check it out today, readingwithyourkids.com/live. Joining us on the line right now from beautiful Orange County in California, just south of Los Angeles. She is a returning guest, and she's also a very patient guest. We've been having some technical difficulties tonight. Please welcome back to the show the author of Sadie and the Paint Shop. Please welcome Deborah Sherrell. Deborah, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much. How are you, Jed Lee?
Excellent, excellent. We've just asked each other that like 10 times in the last 15
minutes. Yeah, but it's a new minute, so we have to know if we're still okay.
That's right. I love that, and I love that you're out creating great books like Sadie and the Paint Shop. Tell us a little bit about it, please.
Thank you so much. Yeah, Sadie and the Paint Shop is the journey of a young, shy girl named Sadie who discovers her voice and overcomes her fears of public speaking through her love of art. But there's more, too, to the story. But that's the main gist of it. But if you are familiar with my work, I do layers of teaching, and my goal is to write books that heal, instruct, and inspire. So it's never about one thing. There's usually layers.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting that you're tackling the subject of public speaking, because that is something I hear is probably the thing that the largest number of people are afraid of, the idea of getting up and speaking in public.
Absolutely. It's can be very scary. And my little character, Sadie, overcomes that. She ends up, she was very, like I said, she was very shy, and it kind of parallels my own life. And I also had a daughter that was the same way. We were kind of shy. I grew up in a large family and very noisy, and you sort of withdraw and then you find your voice eventually. And I really got involved in artwork and did three-dimensional paintings when I was younger, ceramics. And now I've gone back to my sculpture. And so it's just a really cool way, sort of build self-esteem along the way as well.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that you're talking about a character using art to talk about a character who finds her voice. And and you're talking about, too, about you finding your voice through art. And
yes,
that is something that I think people don't realize, that that art, whether it's music, whether it's visual arts, sculpture, painting, photography, acting, it's a wonderful, or even the art of magic, it's a wonderful way for kids and adults to find their voice.
Absolutely. And, you know, art not only is a great way to find your voice, it also binds cultures. And it does give you another form of expression. And I do believe exactly what you were saying, because between art and music, and of course magic as well, it's one of those things that it's universal. So when you find that connection, it's just a really beautiful thing. And unfortunately, in the school system, usually art and music are the first two programs to get cut. So I wanted to sort of use this as a central theme in my book, the importance of art.
Yeah, it really is. I'm at the point in my life, you know, I've been involved in different school systems, either as a volunteer in high school and college, presenting educational magic shows throughout my professional life, been married to a teacher for 30 years. It seems so, a lot of what's going on in education just seems so politicized, and you're right, you know, yeah, things like art and music get cut very, very quickly, and they're replaced with 5 hours of math. Well, I'm exaggerating, but you know, this just rigid, oh, right, we must read for this block of time, we must do math for this block of time, and they don't understand that all of these things are related. You know,
absolutely. You know, and you're right, that there is a huge correlation between mathematics and music. Mm-hmm. Huge. Mm-hmm. So my late husband was a pianist, and as part of what he did, he was also technical, but that's one thing that he was just brilliant at math, and he was also brilliant on the keyboards. So mm-hmm. it was something I really do miss. But yeah, and I want to say that, I have volunteered in the past for decades, actually, because I had an artistic daughter. And that's artistic, not autistic. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So she was so talented that I used to submit her artwork to the Festival of Arts Junior Art Exhibit. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. it would get picked up every year. But I found that through the years of volunteering, less and less children were, their artwork was being submitted. So it used to be that it would take us all day to call the artwork, and now we were getting done before lunch. And that I think is a really sad state of affairs, because it sort of accentuates the fact that the funding is cut, and they're more worried about test scores and the like. And your wife would know that. So it's unfortunate. You know, that art has to take a back seat.
Yeah, absolutely. And that is one of the things that was most frustrating for me, is that schools just seem to go in cycles. And now I was presenting character education programs, and there were just these waves where for a number of years it was, oh, everybody wanted a program that talked to kids about saying no to drugs. And then it was, oh, we have to say no to alcohol. Now we have to say no to tobacco. And now we have to say yes to exercise and my goodness, bullying. Everybody needs to talk about bullying. And
yes.
No, I'm at the point now in my show what it always should have been, which is encompassing everything and just understanding that respecting ourselves and choosing not to be a bully and making healthy choices. They're all related.
I'm with you on that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm just thinking that what you just said, because people don't think about that. It's like, stop telling everyone no. Why don't you start presenting more options and just allow people to develop their talents? Because all of us have something. We all have something that we bring to the table. We all have a talent that shines, and not everyone's going to be a good athlete. Mm-hmm. And not everyone's going to be a good artist. In fact, some people are just absolutely scared to death. They see a blank piece of paper. And while there are those who see an opportunity to create, others see fear because they're like, oh, what am I going to do with this? You know, and then what's expected of me? And everyone's trying to be the best at everything. Mm-hmm. And instead of just like developing, well, what is it? This person might be a really great singer. I can't sing. Mm-hmm. You know, that's something I've always wished I could do, but probably could get lessons. I'm just saying that, you know, allow people to cultivate what interests them, but make it positive. And I think the music and the art, these are good places to start. They really are.
You just mentioned something that, as I think about it, is fascinating. Two people look at the same piece of paper, and there's nothing on it, and one person reacts with fear, and what am I going to do with this? And the other person reacts with, whoa, what an opportunity.
Exactly. That's kind of, and I'm one of the people who kind of likes the opportunity, but I also have to say, when you really see someone who's truly has talent in that area, it's much like a finely tuned athlete. If you watch the Olympics and, you know, you see like the gymnastics and how much dedication that takes and how much skill, it's just unbelievable. And I admire that. But I also, in having a daughter that was really, she was kind of like one of the old masters type of drawing. Mm-hmm. When she would do pencil drawings, it's almost as though she was uncovering what was already there underneath the white. And I don't know how else to describe it, but I just don't even know how she would do that. It's almost like she would just start in a corner or somewhere and then it would just branch out from there. And I really, that's something I really admire, that someone could be that gifted at art.
Now, I've heard, and it might have been a famous sculptor, and some people just repeated it, but I've heard sculptors say that their job is to discover the image, the sculpture that is within the rock or the piece of wood or whatever medium they're using.
Yeah, that absolutely. And thanks for mentioning that, because there are some little secrets inside my book of Sadie and the Paint Shop. Because I do sculpture, I've started doing some busts. So it's just like the neck and the head. Mm-hmm. And I did one that I called Pedro because I named my sculptures. And this little guy, I just loved him so much because he just came from my imagination. And he's pretty much just a little Mexican man who's just very happy with his situation in life. He's just full of love and he loves nature, but he's not about materialism. And the story goes that he found this straw hat on the side of the road and he put it on his head and he just liked it. And so he's very smiley. And I showed that sculpture to my artist. And he said, you know, when we're doing this book, Sadie in the Paint Shop, I would like to make I'd like to have Pedro in there. And so that's what we did. So I said, well, you can incorporate Pedro as long as you put in a self-portrait of yourself on the wall as my little character Sadie is walking through an art studio. And so those two items are in the book. It's kind of our little inside joke. But like you said, you know, it's really important to be able to express artwork. And in my case, doing Pedro, it just came clearly out of my head. And normally I would work with some photographs or whatever. And I remember getting chided because I didn't use photographs. And I'd say, I really don't need them. This character's in my head. And then my instructor would go, yeah, but you'll never get that hat to stay on. And I'm like, watch me. And of course, I did create him. And I'll never sell Pedro. He is one of my very favorite sculptures that I own. And just another side note, I just think it's kind of funny, but many times we take pictures in the house and Pedro's on a table. And if Pedro's in the picture and we're taking pictures of other people, you know how Facebook wants you to identify or tag whoever is there. Uh-huh. Well, Facebook would often ask me to tag Pedro, like, who's this? And that used to make us laugh so hard. And, you know, sometimes it would creep us out because it looks like there's somebody there on the table and they're not there. So anyway, I guess it could go both ways. But anyway.
Well, that's really, really cool. And it also brings up something that the whole facial recognition thing that's going on in social media and in technology scares the life out of me. It is just bizarre. And when it started, when I would post a picture and all of a sudden, Facebook or Instagram would say, "Hey, is this Jed Daugherty?" I'm like, "Whoa, wait a minute."
Yeah. It does get a little scary, I have to say. We're just not used to it. It's mm-hmm. just, it's new technology and we're kind of old school.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't mind that though. I really don't. So in my book, Sadie in the Paint Shop, I also have another theme mm-hmm. and it's about geography. And I have to say that was never a strong suit of mine, but, you know, and I would like to travel more in the future. So I decided to kind of incorporate the presentation that my little character Sadie has to make in front of the class as an International Day project where we are learning about cultures and different countries around the world. And in doing that, I had so much fun because I was learning a lot myself. Oh. And so I actually taught myself while I was writing for others.
That's great. Yeah. Yeah. Well, we are all in favor of that whole idea of learning other cultures. We opened up our home to international students and it was such a wonderful experience. We've hosted kids from China and Italy and India and the Netherlands.
Wow.
And, and now that our kids, we've done a lot of traveling to, the Caribbean and Central America, and it's really is a blessing. And that's another thing about, you know, we were talking about the technology and how weird it is that, you know, machines can recognize your face. But it's also amazing that we're living in a time where I can hop on a plane and be in another continent in just 6 or 7 hours.
Oh, absolutely. I'm with you on that. In fact, I have a friend who is from New Zealand, and one of my life goals is to go to Australia, which, you know, it's not that far. So, my friend has been building his home, his dream home. He married an American, but he has dual citizenship. Mm-hmm. And so he has invited us, and it was really a neat thing for the new year. I sent an email to all of us, friends and colleagues, and said, get your passports ready because our home will be finished by the end of July. So that's where I'm going. I'm going to dust off that passport and I am totally going to be in New Zealand and hopefully Australia at the end of the year.
Well, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. New Zealand is, from everything I heard, it's a beautiful, beautiful place. Now, what kind of conversations do you think a parent and child could have as they're reading Sadie and the Paint Shop together?
Well, basically, what my goal, like I said, I write books that heal, instruct, and inspire. But I also, my books are multicultural, and they have positive messages. And my goal is to allow the parents to bond with their children over these positive themes that I've incorporated in the book. And I think I'm reaching my core audience. You know, there are always more ways to improve and to, get your message to reach out to more people. But, from the people's comments to me, it seems like I think I'm getting there. So that's pretty exciting because I try not to do anything gimmicky. Anybody can do a rainbow or some goofy thing that, you know, every child goes, "Oh, I want that." But I want something that's relevant. I want to hit on themes that are specific to improving humanity. And it sounds like you're very similar in what you're telling me. So,
we try, long ago, I stopped trying to stopped trying to change the world and decided that if I could change one person's world, that would be an accomplishment.
Absolutely. You know, I mean, you just did that because you said you hosted students from around the world. And I mean, how much fun is that? Because everyone gets to learn about everyone else's culture.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it's all about. When I go to a foreign country, I really want to immerse myself in that.
Yeah.
I want to learn about them and what they do and what their traditions are.
Yeah.
And I do have a lot of friends that are from around the world, and some of my favorite friends from different countries. Yeah. You know, like South Africa or France or, you know, of course, my New Zealand friend is. And then I have a friend from Chile,
mm-hmm.
and she's awesome. So it's really cool.
Yeah.
You know, I'm loving it.
You know, one of the things that was really a surprising benefit of hosting international kids and also just of opening up your home to folks from different parts of the world or different parts of the country is that in showing these folks your culture and your city, you're also learning more about your city and you're becoming more familiar with your own home.
Right.
Yeah.
That's correct. Yeah. I mean, I have to say I've been a native Californian and I have not seen all of California. So, you know, I'm almost embarrassed to say that, but I am ready to venture out more. I was very busy for many, many years, obviously raising children and, I actually had a chronically ill spouse, so that kind of kept us sort of cloistered, but I'm ready to branch out now.
There you go. Well, I can give you a pass for not seeing all of California. I've met people who've lived in Rhode Island all of their life, and they haven't been to all of Rhode Island, and that's just ridiculous because you can walk the whole state of Rhode Island in a couple of days. But California is a different
Okay.
California is a little bit different. So you get a pass, you get a little bit more time to finish that up. So where
Thank
can
you.
Folks go? I love the name of your website. Can you let folks know what the name of your website is and why you gave it that name?
Yes, healingtreearts.com is the name of my website. Thank you for asking. And Healing Tree Arts, I created it as a future entity. I wanted to create an art center where people could come and they would heal from in using various modalities that are healthy, you know, and maybe have a forum for grief and loss as well. I imagine this center being located in a canyon somewhere, and I don't know where the canyon is, but I've actually walked this center in my head. And there's a beautiful room that you walk into where there's animal therapy and maybe some areas for meditation and book readings. And then going further into the center, there is a bookstore and an auditorium where lectures are held, various lectures to teach people almost anything. And then classrooms and a venue for events. And then in the back, or off to the side, is a therapeutic horseback riding program.
Cool.
So it would be so cool. And, you know, a lot of that incorporates things that I have in my own life. I mean, my oldest daughter used to volunteer for a place called Fran Joswick, and she saw people actually go from wheelchairs to walking because of the horse therapy.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, that to me would be so exciting. So that's why I wanted to give it a name like Healing Tree Arts, and obviously the art is incorporating my love of art and, you know, my family's love of art as well. But then the healing part, and then what could be more universal than trees? So my very first book was Baby Lauren and Theodore, and it's an environmentally friendly book. It goes through the life cycle of the sugar maple tree, and it's also a story of friendship, love, loss, and renewed hope. So it's just a very universal theme that ties all of us, because we need trees for life.
Absolutely, absolutely. And we need great books for life too, to spark our imaginations, to start beautiful conversations between us and our kids, and between us and some of our friends, because sometimes we need some inspiration to get conversations going between friends too. I want to encourage everybody to check out Deborah's website. It's healingtreearts.com. And, of course, we want you to check out the brand-new book, Sadie and the Paint Shop, a great picture book. And Deborah's telling me it's kind of a, kind of on the cusp of, it's a picture book, but it has more sophisticated language than a typical picture book. And it has more language that you might find in an early chapter book.
Absolutely. Thank you, Jedley. You've said that very well.
Oh, great. tonight we've been talking to our friend, Deborah Sherrell. Deborah, thank you so very, very much for being part of our show tonight.
Oh, thank you, Jedley. Thank you for having me, and continued good luck.
Please be sure to join us for the next edition of the Reading With Your Kids podcast. Our guest will be Amy Andren. She's going to be here to tell us about her heartwarming book, More Than the Moon. Hey, if you are the author of a heartwarming book, or a fun book, or a mystery book, or a spooky book, any kind of book that is aimed at a child, whether they're newborns, or preschoolers, or middle graders, or high schoolers, if you're the author of a great children's book, we would love to have you as a guest on the podcast. Being a guest gives you the opportunity to tell thousands of people about your great children's book. I mean, I have to tell you, I've been absolutely blown away. Ever since we were nominated for the iHeartRadio Best Kids and Family Podcast Award, our downloads have skyrocketed. And that is great news for you, because it means being a guest in the show gives you an opportunity to tell even more people about your great children's book. And let's face it, it is hard getting noticed. There are so many different children's books out there, so many different children's movies out there, so many, many opportunities for parents to spend their time and spend their money. It's hard getting noticed. We want to help you get noticed. And check it this out. This is the best thing. Being a guest on the podcast is fun, it's easy, and it is absolutely free. All you need to do is go to our website, readingwithyourkids.com, click on the contact button, let us know about your great book. We will let you know the next easy steps. Hey, I want to thank Deborah Sherrell for being here today. And of course, we want to thank you. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us. And as always, thank you so much for taking the time to read with your kids. I'll be looking for you in the next edition of the Reading With Your Kids podcast.